times to be a follower, an analyst, or commentator on the Middle East. In fact, it's not an easy time to be the Middle East. And I'm not referring, or at least not referring exclusively, to the dreadful state, the depressingly dreadful state of the Middle East today, to what I would call an arc of disenchantment that took us from a time, a fleeting time, just a few years ago, when a lot of us thought that the Middle East, and the Arab world in particular, might be on the verge, on the brink of a major transformation, democratic opening, and the end of the reign of sclerotic regimes. It took us from that to a time when we thought that perhaps the Arab world could transcend sect, ethnic identification, one-man rule, and yet that arc took us straight back into an era of intense sectarian conflict, intense ethnic identification, and intense authoritarian rule. It's an arc that took us from the belief, the growing belief, that perhaps we could, we the West, could engage with moderate political nonviolent Islamists, back to a time when the narrow obsession seems to be to kill as many jihadists as possible. It's an arc that began in Tahrir Square in Egypt, where people came out to demonstrate, and then landed squarely in the killing fields of Syria and Libya and Yemen. And it's an arc that took us from a time when we thought that perhaps we could celebrate freedom for millions of people living in the Middle East, to a time when we're grateful because we could celebrate the release of a single Egyptian-American, a graduate of this university, as I'm told, Aya Hijazi, who was finally cleared of the absurd charges that were brought against her by the Egyptian authorities just the other day. So I'm not talking about all that, even though all that is part of the picture, of course. I'm not talking about what's happening in the Middle East, because what I want to talk to you about today is something slightly different. It's a different struggle, a different arc of disenchantment, a different disillusionment, but it's the struggle, less violent, although violent in its own way, the struggle that has afflicted the community of those about of whom I suspect there's some in this room, who at some point wanted to engage in the fight for a more enlightened, more progressive U.S. policy in the Middle East. And what has happened to that community as a result of what's happened over the many, several recent years has been a degree of division, a degree of polarization, with bitterness, broken ties, frayed friendships, about which Bassam, I'm sure, knows a lot. And that has divided that community that at one point was united in the belief that they could fight for more, as I say, progressive U.S. policy towards the region. So much so that I have to say that in my last quarter century working on this issue, I've never seen the debates being as bitter, as polarized, as aggressive as they are today. Now, part of what accounts for that, what I'd call that bitter fracture, for those divisions, is the ubiquitous Twitterization of our public debate and our public discourse, which substitutes absolutism for doubt and certainty for nuance and black and white for gray, because it's hard to express ambivalence in 140 characters. But that's not the only reason. Rather, as I reflected upon this as I prepared for today's talk, what's happened is a series of incremental events that have destroyed whatever consensus might have existed at one point about what an enlightened U.S. foreign policy might be. So that what at first were slight nuances in approaches towards the Middle East became a yawning gap. And not just different views, but often competing and incompatible views. Now, the first event that begins in a very imperceptible way to create a fissure among within that community is 9/11. Most people reacted in similar ways, but 9/11 did open up a debate about the nature of Islam, the connection between moderate political Islam and violent Islam, and how Western societies should react to them, and whether it is Islam, a deviation of Islam, or the nature of Islam that led to the what we witnessed on 9/11. That crack widened in 2003 with the war in Iraq. Now, the majority of those who I would identify as progressive thinkers about the Middle East opposed the war, although some of them chose to back this war of choice. But even among those who disputed the legitimacy of the war and thought that it was one of the grave error. There were differences among that group between those who were persuaded that the very idea of the United States going into a Middle Eastern country and trying to engineer a new political order, that that very idea was rotten at its core, and those who believe that if implemented correctly, if implemented wisely, it might produce some good. So there were those who argued that the U.S. should try, once it was in Iraq, to influence its leadership, to push it into a more inclusive direction, and those who believed that the United States simply lacked the capacity, the understanding, the wisdom to get it right. Now, echoes of that divide in 2003, which may not have been that notable, stayed with us over the years, and they reverberated up until today. For some, having entered unlawfully and wrongfully, it was America's duty to see the job through. For others, having invaded illegitimately and illegally, it was America's duty to get the hell out. For some, Iraq was just one case that went wrong. It was a case in which the Bush administration wrongly implemented a policy with the wrong plan, wrong execution, wrong ideas. For others, it stood as a much broader cautionary tale that applied far more than simply to Iraq and far more than simply to the Bush administration. It applied to the Middle East as a whole and applied to the United States as a whole, and it was a lesson about the perils of using military force to engineer political change, about the United States' inability to predict, shape, even understand the realities of the Middle East and the dynamics of the Middle East. Now, 8 years later, with the Arab Spring and the Arab uprisings, whatever consensus existed, whatever common vision existed among people who had, as they say, grown up together thinking about the Middle East, whatever consensus existed was shattered. Because from then on, everything was up for grabs and up for debate. A debate about the relative importance of human rights and democracy versus the relative importance of stability. A debate about the merits of American involvement, and I don't only mean military involvement, on behalf of pursuing human rights and democracy and promoting change. A debate about whether one could divorce what was happening locally in Syria or in Yemen or Libya and Egypt from the broader manipulations of regional powers and international powers. And of course, a debate about the very nature of political Islam, specifically whether it represented a barrier to or a gateway to violent extremism. Now, some of these disagreements remained at a low boil, and we saw them play out when it came to Egypt. Some people thought that it was America's duty to call on President Mubarak to step down, that it was America's duty to engage with the Muslim Brothers, and whether that it was America's duty to denounce President Sisi when, or then not President Sisi, when he toppled Morsi. But the real debate, the real disagreements concerned Libya, because that entailed the question of military intervention. But in each case, the outcome of what happened in Egypt, the outcome of what happened in Libya, didn't do anything to narrow the differences or smooth over the disagreements. To the contrary, each saw in what happened validation of his or her pre-existing views. So some people felt that because of what happened, looking at what happened in Egypt, it would have been far better for the U.S. to stand clearly for human rights and democracy and oppose any attempts to renege on that promise. That we should have been much tougher with Sisi when he toppled Mubarak and perhaps imposed sanctions on Egypt. And then there are others who, because of what happened and because of the chaos that ensued after President Morsi was elected, because of the state of Egypt and the relationship between secularists and Islamists in Egypt, some of them drew the exact opposite conclusion, that the U.S. should have stayed out, it should not have tried to promote democracy or human rights or change in Egypt, and that it understood the situation so poorly and could influence it so poorly as well, that in the end, by intervening, it left itself at the mercy of the criticism of all sides, Islamists, secularists, pro-government, anti-government. Everyone in the end blamed the US for what it had done. And the same is true with Libya. Some people thought it was the right thing to do to intervene to try to prevent a massacre in Benghazi, and perhaps we should have intervened more to prevent further instability in the country. And those who felt that by intervening, the United States and others had opened the Pandora's box that led to polarization, tribal conflict, ethnic conflict, and the rise of a jihadi stream in Libya as well. But if 9/11 and then the Iraq War and then the Arab Spring did a lot to shatter that consensus, Syria, as you all can suspect and know, was the absolute breaking point, because it brought everything and every issue to the fore and every disagreement to the surface. It divided those who thought that the US should intervene to protect the Syrian people and to help to topple, perhaps, Assad's regime. And then, of course, on the other hand, were those who believed that American intervention, however well-intentioned, could only and typically and always do more harm than good. It prompted debate about America's capacity and effectiveness to effect change by backing local actors, the rebels, the opposition. In Syria, on the one hand, those who thought that by helping people who believed in a new Syria, the United States could help moderate forces who were rising up against a dictatorship, and that it could strengthen those moderate forces against more extremist ones, Al-Qaeda or today ISIS. And then on the other side were the skeptics, who felt that the lesson we should take from history is that those the United States back rarely prevail, and when they do prevail, they rarely act once in power in a way that is consistent with what they said they would do when we backed them in opposition. And who also take from history the lesson that in these revolutions, the spoils tend to go to the more extreme, the more violent, the less tolerant forces. So, in short, the story of Syria was also a story, a magnified story about the United States in the Middle East, about the questions it faces, the choices it has to make, and how best it could promote not just its interests, but the interests of the people of the Middle East. My point today is not to argue the merits or demerits of any particular view about what the United States should have done in Syria, though I suspect that might come up in the question and answer. My point is really to try to understand why Syria and everything else has given rise to such different reactions among people who follow the Middle East and who seem to care just as much, each one of them, each one of us, about the fate of the Middle East. Now, Bassam, to whom I owe being here today, has written eloquently about the polemics and the dogma, and often the very personal polemics that Syria has given rise to, and I recommend you read the piece he wrote not that long ago about this issue. But, of course, the background that someone like Bassam brings, or that I bring, or that any one of you brings, that's what shapes your reaction to any given event. That's why some of us may look at Syria and see Iraq, and others look at Syria and see Rwanda, or see Bosnia. So some see the risks and the dangers of US intervention, and others see its promise and its efficiency. So it matters to my mind where we come from, what baggage we carry when we confront events that we witness. And I say this about the Middle East, but of course it would apply about to any area of the world that you are studying or that you are writing about. It makes a difference how we first encounter the problem of the Middle East. It makes a difference what memories we carry, what experience we have, what thoughts we bring to the issue. It colors our perception, and it shapes our biases, and it certainly shaped mine. So I carried, when I encountered Libya or Yemen or the Arab Spring or Syria, I carried memories of my parents, father born of Syrian parents, but himself an Egyptian nationalist, and who fought against Western rule in the Middle East, in the Arab world, and who was a fierce Arab nationalist, and who saw Western involvement as an obstacle to the realization of his aspirations and the aspiration of his brothers and sisters. My mother, who shared the same suspicion. She was an American, but she shared the same suspicion, volunteered for the Algerian National Liberation Movement, again, as a reaction to what she saw as a pernicious effect of Western involvement. I also grew up at a time when the ill effects, the ill-fated effects of American intervention, whether it was in Vietnam or in Central America, were visible to me, and that was part of the experience that I brought when years later I would have to write about and then help shape U.S. policy in the Middle East. My graduate years were spent studying the case of Algeria, which was a lesson, and I kept those lessons many years afterwards, both about the disillusion, the War of National Independence, and then the disillusionment that followed that independence as a result of the coming to power of a narrow-minded autocratic rule. But also the risks presented by intolerant Islamist parties and the risk presented by an attempt to violently crush them. That's the experience of Algeria, for those of you who may have followed it. Years of bloodshed because of an election that brought to power an Islamist group and then the determination of the army to crush it. I also carried, as Bassam said, years of experience working at the International Crisis Group, whose motto was, put yourself in the shoes of the people you talk to. Talk to everyone, first of all, whether they are labeled terrorists or not. Just talk to everyone. And so I encountered people who were militants at Hamas or Hezbollah, Iranians, others. Talk to them, listen to them, try to understand them. And what I carried from that experience was the vast gulf that separated the United States' perception of its actions and the perceptions that others in the region had of those actions, and the labels that we affixed to certain groups and how those groups reacted to those labels, and how local groups can frustrate far mightier powers like the United States because they know their territory better, because they're not a transient presence, but they're going to be there for good, and because they often care far more about the future of their country and therefore are prepared to sacrifice more for it than Americans or Western people. And those years at Crisis Group, of course, were the years of the Iraq War, and that for me was an object lesson in the dangers of the combination of U.S. arrogance and ignorance, of hubris and of the dream that we could remake countries in our own image. So that was my baggage, and I suspect that's why I was drawn to and continue to be drawn to President Obama, because he brought to the Middle East some of these instincts that I recognize, a wariness about our never-ending wars, an appreciation for the power of power, but also an appreciation for the limits of power. I was drawn to his determination to draw down our presence in Iraq at the time, 150,000 troops, which he believed was unsustainable, was distorting our priorities, and creating consequences that were both unpredicted and unpredictable. His determination to reach a deal, a nuclear deal with Iran, both in order to ensure that Iran would not develop a nuclear weapon, but also to guard against the risk of getting bogged down in another long-term war with unpredictable consequences. So in other words, I was drawn to what I saw as a hard-headed, realistic pursuit of specific goals, narrow goals that he thought the United States could accomplish, without inadvertently drawing us into another costly, never-ending war, unforeseen consequences that would provoke a backlash, including among those that we purportedly were trying to help. Now, in making his own choices, he too seems to have been guided by his own baggage, the things he carried, the memories he had with him. Because he said at one point, we have history in Iran, we have history in Indonesia and Central America, so we have to be mindful of our history when we start talking about intervening and understand the source of other people's suspicions. Now, having said that, there's much in the record of the Obama administration that I obviously am in part responsible for that leaves me with painful questions. Why weren't we able to do more to promote Israeli-Palestinian peace? Why weren't we able to do more to stop the bloodshed in Libya or in Yemen? And of course, in Syria, always in Syria. So I'll leave it to students of the region, many of whom I suspect are in this room, to write the balance sheet of the Obama administration. I'm confident there are things that we should have and could have done differently, and that the results could have and should have been different. But I'm also confident that his administration, our administration, will have been judged to be prudent in some ways and wise in other ways, and that at least he avoided some of the main pitfalls that some of his predecessors encountered. I would say to you that this is the baggage I carried. Those are the memories that I brought, and those are the experiences that I brought to the Middle East. So ask yourselves, what is your baggage? What do you bring when you judge whether or not the United States should strike, whether President Trump was right to strike Syria, whether President Obama was right not to in 2015? What do you bring to your experience when you look at what's happening in the Middle East about whether we should, in fact, try to improve our relationship with Egypt, or whether we should make respect for human rights and democracy a sine qua non? What is your history? What do you bring with you when you make those assessments? Think about the roots of your thoughts. Think about the genealogy of your thinking. Why you react in a certain way, why you prefer certain outcomes, why you prefer certain policies. And if you do that, you might emerge with a more critical understanding of your own thought process. You might even emerge with some doubt. And I know that that's kind of a radical concept in this age of Twitter and social media, where doubt seems to be the enemy. The only thing that seems to work is certainty and the hubris that comes with it. But to doubt oneself in this era of social media and Twitterization, that for me represents something a little bit more than a symbolic victory. It would represent a small triumph. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. Dr. Malley, I'm very pleased that we actually will have quite a bit of time for an engaged discussion. I will open the floor and take a few questions at a time. The questions actually should be preceded by you identifying yourself, and I'm no person to actually demand that because I forgot to identify myself during this whole event. My name is Bassam Haddad. I am the director of the Middle East and Islamic Studies program, and that's about it. So I will actually take questions about three or four at a time, and I'll ask you to identify yourself and keep your questions to a minute or comments. You can actually feel free to make comments. Mark?
Yeah, just very quickly, President Obama's decision not to engage militarily in Syria, was it strictly a matter of constitutional interpretation and the president's authority vis-a-vis Congress, or did the decision go deeper than that? Did it involve more sort of strategic considerations about the Middle East?
Thank you. Did you have, okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah, my name's Weston Miller. I'm an undergraduate student in the School of Conflict Analysis and Resolution. But I was just gonna ask, whenever John Kerry did his negotiations with the Russian Federation surrounding the surrendering of Assad's chemical weapons, was there sort of an underlying trust there that the deal would go through and be successful, or was the Obama administration sort of always suspicious that the situation that aroused would end up coming up?
Thank you. Noura?
Noura Erica, professor and assistant professor at the School of Integrated Studies. Two-part question. The first part is also related to the decision not to militarily engage in Syria. What we understood publicly anyway, is that it was a decision that the cost was far, far outweighed the benefit and the outcome, and that the pivot to Asia should be the main priority. So the question underlying that, what had been guiding U.S. foreign policy in the Middle East? Was it a greater concern with ensuring our military kind of edge at the lowest possible cost, or was there also a moral political consideration that shaped that outcome?
Okay, we'll stop here, and then the next round, you will go first.
Sure.
Dr. Greenberg, I'll leave it up to you, and then we'll do the...
Sure, so all questions have to do with 2013. So first, a caveat, I was not in the administration in 2013, so everything I'm going to say is based both on reading what you all read, and then obviously having spoken to some of the people who were involved in it since then. You know, I don't know, President Obama has spoken about that decision on several occasions, so I'm not going to try to interpret his own thought process. I don't think that it was simply a matter of constitutional prerogative, Congress versus the executive, since he said he thought that he had the legitimacy to strike even without congressional authorization. He maintained that before, he maintained it during and after. But it all comes together. I think several things had happened. Obviously, there was no Security Council endorsement. The British Parliament had just voted against it as well. And he sensed that he didn't have strong support domestically. Now, if, on the other hand, now I'm going to speculate, if he felt that it was a slam dunk, that it was the right thing to do, that he should just do it, I think those considerations might have paled. But I think there was the feeling of the danger of a slippery slope, of getting involved, and again, I'm not saying anything he hasn't said publicly, that we strike, as President Trump just did, and what do we do if the next day there's another attack? Do we say, well, we just said we're going to strike once, or we're going to strike again? Or do we keep going, and then how do we get out? And of course, again, everything I mentioned about the risks and the dangers of the U.S. military involvement were paramount in his mind. That said, he has intervened militarily in the Middle East, so this was not a blanket rule that he would not take military action. And what he pivoted to, not to Asia, was the Russia deal. And the Russia deal, again, for him and for me looking back, what the Russian deal did, and yes, it's true that not all the chemical weapons were removed, but they were, say, roughly 1,300 tons of chemical weapons that were stored in Syria at the time. The purpose of the strike, and this was very clearly stated by President Obama in 2013 and by President Trump just a few weeks ago or so, was not regime change, not to end the war, was to deter or prevent the use of chemical weapons by the regime. By getting 1,300 tons out of Syria, you certainly reduced the risk of a major use of chemical weapons. Not everything was removed. And in fact, I think if you listen to what U.S. officials said between 2013 and 16, they acknowledged that not everything had been removed and that some had remained behind. We were not trusting the Russians. We were trusting the OPCW, the organization that received the Nobel Peace Prize for its work in removing the chemical weapons. So I think, you know, it wasn't a trust of the Russians. The deal was made. It was going to be verified. It is true, again, that chemical weapons were left behind, and I think the question to be asked today is, would we be better off having struck in 2013, and I'm going to try to present this neutrally if I can, striking in 2013, sending a strong message, perhaps deterring the regime, perhaps even rattling the cage and making Assad more nervous about other forms of warfare, but leaving behind over 1,000 tons of chemical weapons, which today could be vulnerable to ISIS or to Al-Qaeda, or could be used by the regime in a moment when it felt that it was about to be toppled. So which one of those is the better road? Really, it's up. I think each one can make up his or her own mind. I do think it's worth noting that between 2013 and 2017, the regime did not use chemical weapons in the way it did use chlorine, which we could get to, but it didn't use the kind of chemical weapons against Syrian civilians in the way that it provoked what happened in 2013 or what happened in 2017. So in some ways, you could argue the deterrence worked to some extent. Of course, he used them again. And then one has to debate whether the strike now is going to have the effect of deterring the regime from using it again. I suspect it will. And I suspect that Bashar was both testing the new administration, but also facing a difficult situation in the province, in the province where he chose to use those chemical weapons, which I think, again, is a reminder that if he's in a desperate situation, he will use, as he has continued to use, despicably desperate means. Nor your question about sort of moral considerations, I don't think, again, because he, you know, President Obama's continued to get involved in the Middle East, and by the end of his term in office, had 5,000 men and women in Iraq and about 500 in Syria. So it's not we're going to just do Asia and we're going to leave the Middle East alone. But I do think, and again, this is why I keep coming back to our histories matter. how we look at things matter. I think he identified the Middle East as a place where we had wrongly invested resources in a way that didn't do us good, but frankly didn't do the people of the Middle East good. I mean, this is the difference that I see between the isolationism or the retrenchment that President Trump spoke about, which he doesn't seem to be implementing, but that he spoke about, which was all about how getting involved in the Middle East was bad for us. I think for President Obama, it was also that it was not very good for them. In other words, our interventions did not result in the goals that we had assumed and that we the reasons why we had gotten in the first place. And that's true, by the way, of military interventions, not just in the Middle East. And I think the administration had asked for a study back in, I don't know if it's 2013 or 14. Let's look at U.S. military involvement in case after case. Is there one, give us a case where supporting a rebel group in a foreign country ended up redounding to the U.S. benefit and succeeding in the way that it was predicted to succeed at the time the intervention took place. As I recall, when the study was done, again, I wasn't in the administration, maybe there were one or two cases that on the margins you could say were successful. And I'm not talking about World War II, World War I. I'm talking about when you help an insurgent group try to overthrow a regime. The balance sheet is almost entirely negative. I think that also influenced the administration's view, the president's view, and for all his sympathy for parts of the opposition, I think he never was convinced that intervening on their behalf would lead to the happy outcome that people wanted. As I said, I think Syria is by far the most difficult case and the one that I still question myself about whether we made the right decision, whether we could have done something differently. But at bottom, I think it comes down to the baggage one carries and why one reacts to a certain event the way one does. It's sometimes it really has to be the prism through which you're going to view a certain event. Some people in the administration, whenever Syria came up, they thought about Bosnia, and they thought about Srebrenica, and they thought about Rwanda, and you know who I'm referring to. And others, when they thought about Syria, they thought about Iraq, and they thought about other cases, other instances of U.S. military intervention that turned sour.
Thank you very much. I just discovered the microphone. The wireless, so I'm going to ask you to use it so that we could all hear it. We'll start with Professor Greenberg.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Malley, for your talk. I think in the spirit of your talk, I have sort of an ambivalent question, but I absolutely love that you're integrating this idea of sort of politics of perception, as Rancière famously talked about, and our own subjectivity and how we understand objective phenomena. But my question is about the manipulation or misinformation campaigns that we see, that we are now fully aware of, executed by Russia and so forth. And I'm wondering, I want to cast it back to summer of 2014, I guess, and fall 2014. And I actually want to ask you about Tanzima Daula and ISIS when Baghdadi came out. There's a prevailing dominant conspiracy theory or narrative in the Middle East that the group was a sort of monster creation of American or and Israeli policies. I mean, Donald Trump himself said that Clinton was the founder of ISIS and Obama and so forth. And this kind of the role, I want to ask you about the role of conspiracy theories in controlling some of these problems. And if the administration was ever concerned about misinformation campaigns from the Russians in the midst of the Syrian conflict, on the heels of the Arab Spring, and did any of the misinformation campaigns become a point of discussion during your time serving the administration?
Thank you. Nora, are you going to go?
Yeah.
Okay, I don't want to be accused of nepotism because I gave the microphone to my wife thinking that she would leave to get our daughter so I can have the cookie, but she's not leaving. So we'll ask Ahmed. We have to get a Muslim in there.
Thank you, Dr. Malley. My name is Ahmed Selim Tekel, although I am with the Ali Bralak Center for Global Islamic Studies and the editor of its online publication, the Meydan. My question will appeal to your introspective voice. I also loved that voice. I'm wondering to what extent your years in the field with ICG and working with Islamists informed your perspective, the way you pitched in to the debates about Islamists and devising policy, where contexts were defined by the Islamists from Turkey to Egypt to many other contexts. If you could reflect on the impact of that work and what you heard from them, their perceptions of the U.S., to what extent was it part of your portfolio and your contributions to the administration? Thank you.
Quick question.
I'm
going to
leave. Robert, I'm going to leave, but I just want to ask a quick question. I'll be on tape, so I'll get to hear the answer to it. But this idea that we didn't intervene in order to benefit the local population as opposed to entrench our position, I wonder how that squares with the fact that even in the absence of our kinetic intervention, that our aid to Egypt, to Israel, our weapons exchange with Saudi Arabia makes us very much an omnipresent force, that even in the absence of intervention, we're very much there. So then, related to that is, in your involvement in the Iranian rapprochement, how did that leverage our relationship with Saudi Arabia in order to resolve regional tension that exists in the proxy conflict between Iran and Saudi Arabia, or did that diminish our leverage with them? Thank you.
Hi, Habiba. I'm a freshman. I was wondering, in light of the current events or the current issues that are facing the Middle East, whether in specific countries or just general conflicts, what do you think is going to be, in the future, the biggest conflict facing the Middle East, and the way that the United States interact with these conflicts in terms of, in light of, you know, ISIS and the expansion of ISIS and the civil war in Syria and also corruption in Middle Eastern countries? How do you think that's, what do you think, which or what conflict is going to be grow to pose the biggest threat to the community and to the United States? Thank you.
We'll take one more, and then Jonathan, because you're from London.
Thank you. So in your opinion, what does history, does that impede good policy? That's
what I thought. Can you identify yourself?
Okay.
Can you identify yourself?
Oh, I'm Jonathan from the UK.
This is doubling up. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Now these questions are in all directions, so not like last set. Misinformation campaign. Maybe we didn't think about it exactly in those terms, but it was clear that there was a every time something happened in Syria, the Russian version, and they were very good at it, would blast out, you know, if they or the regime hit a humanitarian aid convoy, which was one of the turning points, at least in our engagement with the Russians. Sort of, at that point, it kind of destroyed any hope we had of really getting a settlement. They had a thousand different theories, as they just have now with the sarin gas, sarin attack. I don't think we're quite as good at countering it, because for whatever reason, I don't think that we launched media campaigns the way they did, and it's easier if you just have one version and you're just going to propagate it the way they did. We tried to take it into account in terms of how we would try to shape the narrative and how we'd have certain pronouncements at a certain time. I know personally I didn't spend enough time thinking about it, but partly because it was so obvious propaganda, but one probably dismisses the impact of propaganda in shaping people's minds. I do think, though, on the Syrian conflict, people's minds are already set. So those people who want to believe that the regime used sarin gas or bombed the humanitarian convoy would believe it no matter what, and those people who believe that it's always either us or the opposition, they'll believe that. So I'm not sure that the Russians managed to change that many minds, but it's a fair question. And in light of what we now know, and which I didn't know at the time because it wasn't issues that I was working on, Russia, you know, everything takes on a slightly different shade. My time at Crisis Group, so first I'm going to answer, it wasn't really the question you asked, but it's something that has always stayed with me, which again I think has informed my view about the region. I met with the then Hezbollah's number two, he may still be number two, Naim Qassem, back in 2011, after the outbreak, or maybe 2012, after the outbreak of the Syrian uprising, but at a time when it wasn't clear what direction it was headed. And I kept pressing him, what would you do if Assad were actually toppled? And he spent 20 minutes rejecting the hypothesis. But when he finally answered, he said, okay, let's assume he's toppled. Who do you think deals better with chaos? Us, by which I think he meant Hezbollah, Iran, or you, the US and the West? He said, think of Afghanistan, think of Iraq, think of Lebanon. Who fares better amidst chaos? And then tell me who should be worried about Assad being toppled. So that did stay with me, because I do think we had to think about what would happen the day after Assad. I don't think that's a dispositive question, but it's something I think people who would say, oh, you know, the opposition will take over, everything will be fine, I think we're projecting at least as tendentious views as those who thought that it would be a nightmare, chaos, and ISIL would take over. But the other question you asked, which is harder for me to answer, is to what extent my interaction with Islamists shaped, you know, my discussions in policy circles. So to some extent, you know, the Obama administration was quite open to engaging with Islamists, and has been criticized for that, talking to the Muslim Brotherhood, talking to, engaging with President Morsi. Now, there's some things that I knew the administration wouldn't do, no matter what experience I had and what background I had, which is talking to some Islamist groups with which it would never talk. But then the other piece of it, which is where to be even more introspective, where perhaps I learned that no matter what one brings to the administration, some political imperatives take over. And I wrote about it in the New York Times about a month ago with a colleague of mine. The counterterrorism imperative becomes so overwhelming that it doesn't really matter. You know, you could try to be subtle about root causes and, you know, the type, there are different shades even of Al-Qaeda and Jabhat al-Nusra. Maybe there's some of them who are not quite the same as ISIS or Al-Qaeda. But once you are in those rooms making decisions and you have to confront the possibility of a terrorist attack that will be blamed on an administration that maybe was not tough enough on terrorists. And I saw how President Obama himself, his own introspective thinking about it, because I don't know anyone who is more analytical about the actual danger that terrorism posed, and saying, for example, and I think he said it publicly, that more Americans died because they slipped in a bathtub than killed by foreign terrorists. But that doesn't work politically, because then you look like you're not taking a very legitimate or very heartfelt fear of the people you're supposed to represent and the people who you're leading, you're not taking it seriously. And I think he felt that he could lose legitimacy and credibility if he didn't take a threat that he believed was not existential, but was serious, but not existential. If he didn't take it as seriously as the people he was governing took it, they would dismiss anything. And if anything went wrong, if there was a terrorist attack, God forbid, that would be the end of his presidency, or he would have to do such an 180 and basically occupy and bomb and make sure that any place where ISIS was present would be blown up, that it would end the presidency and what he wanted to do with it. So I think in some ways he had to cater to public opinion, which he felt probably was over-exaggerating the threat. But if he didn't reflect that, understand it, and embody it, he no longer could really be representing the people. It's a very strange phenomenon, and so I found myself very laser-like focused on what could we do to defeat ISIS. Now, before, when I was at ICG, and now that I'm at ICG, I'm thinking about, you know, root causes, and you could kill 10 terrorists, have you really made a difference? But when you're there and you live in the world, in a political world, which is not just a policy world, but a political world in terms of whether your policies are going to be accepted, and whether you're going to be viewed as actually doing the job that you're elected or chosen to do, the lens becomes distorted. And I think we probably spent far too much time and resources and energy on the counterterrorism struggle, and I think it did at some points distort our priorities. But I understand why it happened, and I'm not sure how it doesn't happen. what was my the next one? I think it was Noor's question about are we not intervening, but we are intervening anyway. And I think that's obviously true, and Bassam, you could relay this tonight. If there's a criticism, and there are many criticisms of the administration, one of them is that the administration was always somewhere in between, right? It said, we are not going to countenance or validate some of the policies that President Sisi was engaged in. We're going to keep somewhat of a distance. But at the same time, $1.3 billion a year, close relations, close cooperation with Egypt. So as I said, angering both those who supported Sisi and those who oppose it, both the Islamists and the secularists, because the United States was supporting it, Egypt too much or keeping it too much at a distance. And you could say the same about policy in Syria. It was not intervening, but nonetheless supporting the opposition and therefore having a role and having shaping the conflict even as we tried in some ways to stay out of it. So I think the critique is that it was neither fish nor fowl, that in some ways the policy in Yemen, not fully backing the coalition's war and actually being very critical of it in some cases and withholding some forms of assistance, but at the same time having very close relations with Saudi, selling the Gulf countries more weapons than probably any administration, and essentially siding with the coalition in that war. So I think that's the, and I think President Obama made the point in one of his press conferences or interviews that U.S. policy, and this would apply to U.S. foreign policy, is like a huge ship, and it moves 1 degree at a time. And you can't really see that difference except over years. Years back, you see this was the moment of inflection. But at the time, it really looks like it's not clear what our policy might have been on Yemen, on Syria, on Israel-Palestine. And maybe if that policy had continued over a decade, you would have seen what big difference Obama made. Of course, he didn't predict, I don't think I or many people in this room predicted that President Trump would win, so that 1 degree may not make much of a difference at all because of the corrective that this administration is going to bring. She also asked a question about the rapprochement with Iran and whether that gave more leverage with Saudi Arabia. Frankly, no. I mean, we tried very hard, and this will bring me to, I think, one question we had about what the biggest conflict or the biggest threat the United States is going to face, what the region is going to face. Big priority of all priorities was for the president was to see what he could do to at least de-escalate tensions between Iran and Saudi Arabia, which have been not just dangerous in and of themselves, but feeding proxy wars in Syria, in Yemen, in Iraq, and elsewhere. He didn't succeed, and I think what the Saudis in particular took as a result of the deal with Iran was a level of distrust towards the president and towards the administration, and kind of waiting him out on the question of Iran and hoping that the next administration would be one that would be much tougher against Iran and much clearer, as they saw it, in confronting Iran, and to some extent they got their wish. And that brings me to the real question about what I think is the biggest threat to stability in the region and where I think the source of conflict will be. I think it is in the Iranian, Saudi or Iranian, whoever you want to call the other side, that antagonism, that hostility. If it's not brought under control, if some arrangements is not found, I think you're going to see conflicts being perpetuated because Saudi Arabia has the money, it has the weapons, it has the international backing, but Iran has learned over years how to do much more with much less. And that's something that, again, the president said directly to Saudi leaders. If you combine the GCC military budget, it's about 8 to 10 times greater than the Iranian defense budget. And yet, every day, the Saudis and the Emiratis were telling us, Iran is on the march in Yemen, it's on the march in Iraq, it's on the march in Damascus, it's on the march in Lebanon. Four capitals are now under Iran's sway. Maybe, I think that's slightly overstated. But what that proves is not necessarily that Iran is this mammoth that can crush everything, but that on the other side there are structural weaknesses. And so that that disparity, that asymmetric conflict, where one side is not going to run out of money, it's not going to run out of military hardware, and it's not going to run out of international support, is going to confront a country that has a way of dealing with the region that has proved to be quite effective and been able to checkmate Saudi Arabia and its allies for some time. The last question, the interesting question about whether history impedes policy making. I mean, you could take my talk and it answers it yes and no, right? And to some extent, you need history, you need experience, you need some knowledge of the region in this case in order not to repeat the mistakes of the past. I think we have to learn some lessons from Iraq. And today, the people think the accusation leveled against the Obama administration is that we overlearned Iraq, perhaps, but there's also danger of forgetting it and forgetting very quickly the lesson that for all America's might, for all its power, and it is enormous, and the things that we can do are, you know, sometimes boggle my imagination. But we're not of the region, we're not from the region, we don't quite understand the region, we're not prepared to sacrifice as much as the people who live there every day, and we're gonna have to live there forever, are prepared to sacrifice. And we unleash forces that we don't control. So history helps. History can be an obstacle. I don't deny, and that's why I do think sometimes we are prisoners of the experience of the past. And as I said, if every time you see Syria, you see Iraq, or every time you see Syria, you see Rwanda, you're being a victim of your own history, and you have to sort of break the mold and see both, or see none, or see a bit of one and a bit of the other. But it's hard because, all we are the sum total of everything that we've lived up to now.
Thank you. We're going to do just one more round, and then we will release you. When someone asked what's the biggest threat to the region, I thought you were going to say Trump, or in the region, because it actually might end up being that way. I will abuse my privilege as a moderator, and I will ask a question. My name is Bassam Haddad, and I am happy to be given this opportunity by myself to ask this question. I would like to ask you about what you think, and I really, and people who have been following you really would value your question, because you're always careful. What do you think is Russia's red line regarding U.S. involvement in Syria? In the past strike, or the recent strike, the idea was that it was in response to a chemical attack, so it could be as a function of that, the Russians just paid some lip service. So is it that what the U.S. is responding to? Is it the scale of the attack? Did we overemphasize Russia as a deterrent all along, and so on and so forth? I mean, I would love to hear what you have to say about that. I mean, maybe there are no red lines, and it's just in our minds, and in the Russian discourse. That's my question. So I will turn to others. Khalid, since you're close.
Khalid, I'm a member of the public interested in the region and our policy in it. My question, I would like to hear your thoughts on the drone war or wars in Yemen. If you could talk about the legitimacy or the way the Obama administration saw that and its effectiveness.
Thank you. We just actually, in my class, some people are here, we just read the book by Jaffer on the drone wars. So people are smiling already, so people are happy to listen to the answer.
I'm Mike Dante. I'm a retired theoretical physicist, so that makes me an expert on the Middle East. My question is, the people that in the West that have really suffered from the Middle Eastern situation have been the Europeans, both in terms of refugees and in terms of actual terrorist strikes. Have we gotten together with them and gotten their ideas? Has there been any attempt to see if there was ideas we could get from the Europeans in terms of how to deal with these issues?
I'm trying to look for some gender diversity? Yes.
Hi, my name is Lamar Crosby. I'm an information systems major, but I find this study quite fascinating. My big question is regarding information. You had mentioned about kind of the over-sensationalizing maybe the threat of terrorism here in the United States about like slipping in the bathtub, but the likelihood of that's higher. We see the situation with chemical weapons in Syria particularly as, I guess, a red line to intervene or to take some sort of action, or at least consider it. We're approaching close to 500,000 or 500,000 lives lost, not all of which have been in that way, but again, the, I guess, shock value moves us to, I guess, some form of action. My question is, how do we as, I guess, students, consumers of media, ultimately kind of stay above the headwinds of, or stay below the headwinds of maybe some of the more variant, the shock value? How can we kind of stay consistent and consume valuable content so we can inform ourselves and ultimately, I guess, shape public opinion in a more proper way?
Thank you. We'll take one more question.
Hi, my name's Graham Scott. I'm a master's political science student here at GMU. If it comes to pass, how do you think Donald Trump's proposed reduction in foreign aid will impact the Middle East?
Thank you very much. This would be the last round, unless somebody's burning to ask a question. Yes, please. No, we would love for you to ask it.
My name is Mustafa Kirkuti. I'm a journalist, London-based. I'm visiting Washington. And it's fascinating to definitely. But I have a very quick question. Is Iran campaign in the region itself sustainable in the view of the US?
Is Iran?
Campaign in the region. Because they are, you know, from Al-Muhit Al-Khalij, from the ocean to the Gulf. Is it sustainable in the view of the US? And also their relation with Iran, with Russia, the combined so-called policy at the moment, is it also sustainable in your opinion?
Thank you very much,
okay.
Robert. This will be the last
okay.
round, and then we will close.
So you asked a question about Russian red lines. I don't have the answer. I do think, you know, a few cruise missiles as a response to chemical attack, that obviously was not a red line. I think it has more to do with the reaction than what it's reacting to. In other words, it's less that it was in reaction to use of chemical weapons, which for all we knew, Russia may have been aware of before the fact. I don't know that, but it's possible that Russia, being present at the military base, knew exactly what the regime was going to do. I think it's the reaction that they are judging. Now, I hate the term red line because I don't know what it means. The question is, what response is a trigger? Would you consider a red line if Russia said after an attack, you can't fly over Syria anymore? Now, you know, maybe we can live with that. You know, we still are fighting ISIS in Syria, but Russia has its air defenses, Syria has its air defenses. It could say, you can't fly over Syrian territory anymore, even if it's to fight ISIS. And then the US has to make a judgment, are we going to defy that, or are we going to take out the air defense, or are we going to simply get out of the way? And there are other ways in which things could get ugly. And you're right that this was a factor in when we were assessing what the Obama administration could do. How would the Russians react? How would the Iranians react? How would others react? Yes, those were factors. Again, I suspect, and I can't say this with certainty, that if President Obama was presented with what he felt was not absolute certainty, but a clear enough pathway from A to B. Here's what I'm going to do. Here's the military operation I'll take. And here's the likely consequence. And here are some of the sort of escape hatches in case, you know, so we don't get dragged in. I think he would have probably, again, I don't know, that he might have said, okay, yes, Russia may react and Iran may react, but this makes sense to me. I think he never was confronted with a plan that to him made sense, that he felt we protect our interests, we do good, because the plan was always, you know, a safe zone, and we could spend hours talking about the safe zone, but it wasn't going to be particularly safe for the people who were going to be living there. We might call it that, but unless we were going to put troops on the ground, which nobody was really proposing, we weren't really going to, it wasn't going to be anything close to safe. And all the other proposals, which he just was skeptical of, and skeptical of the escalatory dynamic, the slippery slope. But you're right that added to that was the fear of, you know, does something happen with the Russians and we end up in a confrontation with them? Or do they simply make our lives more difficult in the things that we actually can't control? Maybe we overstated it, but as I said, I think it wasn't alone, and I don't think it would have been dispositive if other questions had been answered more satisfactorily. And I can say without breaching any secrets that he constantly told his team, okay, you want me to do something else? Come back to me with something that makes sense. And it never convinced him. Some would say that he was not prepared to be convinced. I think if something had really made sense, he would have gone for it. Drone war. In many ways, drone warfare is the quintessential warfare for the Obama administration. No troops on the ground, focused on terrorists, more or less effective, and we could talk about that. Very clinical. It sort of fits the mold. Now, in some ways, that's dangerous because it becomes a very cheap, or at least politically cheap, way to wage war, and people don't really see the civilian casualties when there are some, and there have been mistakes. More than mistakes, people have died as a result. So I'm ambivalent about, it's better to some extent than sort of having manned airplanes that are much less precise and that end up having far more collateral damage if I use that, if I borrow that parlance. But it does make one more addicted to a mode of warfare that seems sort of the equivalent of video games. You press a button and the drone strikes. So I think we have to be very careful more generally about about what the advances in technology are going to mean about our ability and our willingness to engage in war when the costs are not incurred by us, but only by the receiving side. So there's no, you know, historically, wars end partly because both sides bear the cost, and when the cost here becomes, you know, whether it's cost of political cost or the cost in terms of loss of human life, then that acts as a restraint. There's no real restraint with drones. There's no reason why, from a U.S. domestic political side, that wouldn't simply continue and keep growing. The question about the EU. One thing I'd say, and this, I don't know if it's going to make all of you feel better or worse, it's not as if when you sit in government offices, people come up with ideas that you all sitting around the table at a think tank wouldn't come up with as well. So it's not as if the Europeans or anyone else came up with a brilliant idea that we hadn't thought of or that you wouldn't have thought of. It is true that the Europeans have had to bear the brunt of both in terms of refugee flows and in terms of terrorism. But they then have also succumbed to the same, and I say succumb, but it's not that, they were drawn to the same reactions that we were drawn to. We have to go after ISIS, we have to go attack them, we have to kill them in Raqqa or in Mosul. Did they come up with any brilliant ideas? Some of them wanted us to be tougher on Assad. It is true, the French and the Brits thought that we should be more aggressive, particularly the French, and perhaps even, you know, proceed with regime change, but neither one of them had the means to do it or the will to do it without the US backing. So I don't think they had any revolutionary ideas. They had a different problem set that they were facing, but they, I was talking to Bassam about it earlier. One of the problems with the Syrian tragedy is that the discussions go around in circles. People have thought about all the same things, and people who think they'll work 5 years ago think they'll work today, and people who didn't think they would work 5 years ago still don't think they would work. So there's a perverse quality about the Syrian conflict, which is whatever happens. I said it earlier about the Arab Spring, but whatever happens in Syria validates the views of people who hold completely incompatible views to begin with. So the rise of extremists in Syria, for example, makes those who are in favor of military intervention redouble in their belief, because they say, had we intervened, we would have helped the moderates, we would have nipped the rise of extremists in the bud, and we would have been much better off. And those who believe, who oppose military intervention, say, you see, had we intervened, who were the strongest people on the ground? It was Al-Qaeda, it was ISIS. They're the ones who would have taken advantage of the chaos and of whatever else would have occurred. So, unfortunately, history in the making doesn't change the minds of people who are making it. I'm as guilty of it as anyone else. But one extracts from what happens validation of one's pre-existing beliefs. And it's very hard to resist that. The question about the shock value of certain events. I mean, it is true. I mean, if you look at what has gotten people to care about Syria, it's not the 500,000 dead. It's the picture, the tragic picture of the refugee washing off the shores of Greece. It's the picture of the twin brothers, one of whom was killed. It's the picture of sarin gas. It's the emotions that drive. Now that's, I can imagine if I were a Syrian, that would be both, you know, a lesson about how you can try to mobilize people, but also quite sad that it takes that when 500,000 people, 400,000 people dead doesn't do it. It takes one picture. But that is unfortunately, particularly today with the means of communication that exist, that's what seems to mobilize people. And you know, for those of you who are activists, there's a lesson there. That's how you get, you know, President Trump reacted because of what he saw, pictures he saw about babies being killed in Syria. And I actually believe that played a part. I don't know that it was everything, I doubt it, but it played a part. And public opinion matters, and so these pictures matter. It's maybe unfortunate, but I think you have to learn to live with it, and for those, again, who are activists, you have to learn to use it. There's a question about Donald Trump, and I'm trying to read my own handwriting, which I can't. The reduction in foreign aid. So the question answers itself, right? I mean, reduction in foreign aid at a time when we seem to be, contrary to what candidate Trump said, ramping up our involvement in the Middle East, and I'm just going to talk about the Middle East, that seems to be an incongruity. I mean, it doesn't make sense to say we're going to, you know, send more troops into Syria, send more troops into Iraq, do more in different places, but at the same time cut off the funding that will help post-conflict reconstruction, development, etc. So I don't know if that's sustainable, and I think there's going to be pushback, including from those he seems to be listening to most, the generals in his team, who have been the most outspoken about the need for the diplomatic tools. And that was true actually during the Obama administration. The people who are most vocal and most articulate about decrying the lack of a diplomatic plan, game plan, in Yemen or in Libya or in Syria, were the military folks, because they knew that they couldn't carry this to pass the finish line and that others were going to have to do it. And actually, I was heartened to see that General Mattis, Secretary Mattis, said yesterday or today, when asked about Yemen, when all this talk about increasing our own involvement in the war and helping the coalition there, said, what we really need now is a surge in diplomacy to end this war at the negotiating table. Finally, the question about Iran and whether its campaign in the region is sustainable. I mean, to echo what I said earlier, Iran's strength is more of a function of its opponent's weaknesses. You know, Iran faces real ceiling, a sectarian ceiling, for better or for worse. And I said it earlier, there may have been the aspiration, the hope that the Arab Spring would transcend the sect. It has unfortunately only exacerbated the weight of sectarian identification and the role of ethnic identification. So it will face that ceiling, and one of the consequences of the Syria war, as those of you who've studied it know far better than I, is that it has reduced the appeal of organizations like Hezbollah or a state like Iran, because people view it not through the prism of the axis of resistance against imperialism and against reaction, but it's the Shiite axis against the Sunni Arabs. So I think it faces a real sectarian ceiling. It faces a resource ceiling. I mean, I said it earlier, its defense budget even if you count that more money we'll get as a result of the Iran deal, which is not going to be all that much, it still is a pittance compared to what the Saudis and the Emiratis and the Qataris and others could invest in their military. So that's the other ceiling. So I do think, again, I think Iran is exploiting the mistakes of others. It has some real supporters, but it is doing very well with very little because of the mistakes and the policies of those that it is in conflict, and likewise with the Iran-Russia alliance, very tactical alliance. There's no love lost between the Iranians and the Russians, and you know when Russia wants to use Iranian bases to launch attacks, the Iranians have typically said no, with only a few exceptions. Whereas you'd think that now of all times would be a time when they'd want to embrace the Russians to counter what it sees as a growing wall of hostility, particularly by the Gulf Arabs. But it still has that nationalist feeling, which is, and the memories of what happened after the Second World War, it does not want Russia to replace any foreign entity. So I think, you know, it's always bemused me, and I've said this to Saudi officials who I've spoken to, why do you want to hype the Iranian threat as much as you do? I mean, you're actually doing them a favor when you paint them as this mammoth that can crush everything on its path. I mean, you do better focusing on what you need to do to deal with them. And again, this we fell on deaf ears. Ultimately, President Obama used that expression, Iran and the Saudis are going to have to share the region, which is something the Saudis reacted extremely negatively to. But what he meant by that is it's going to have to be some understanding on Iranians, Saudis, Egyptians, and others about a security architecture for the region, similar to some things that may have been established in Europe, a security architecture so that we don't use Libya or Yemen or Syria or Iraq as the killing fields and for proxy wars between countries that may be prepared to fight to the last Syrian. Thank you.